I'm T. Barnes. I'm the clerk of the court. This is Tia Milton, the chief deputy clerk. If anyone is arguing today and has questions about using the ELMO, which is the document production camera, or timing, if you'd please see Ms. Milton before we begin. I haven't heard that we're not going to start on time, so I expect we'll start in about 10 minutes. I want to remind you that there should not be any electronic devices in the courtroom, no telephones or anything else that makes noise. And also, if you have any water bottles or anything, please don't take them out. Thank you.
S13G1812, Metropolitan Atlanta Rapid Transit Authority versus Michael G. Reid, Michael Bagley for appellant, Todd Major for appellee.
Thank you, sir.
We have some devices around to help you keep up with your own time, but you'd be responsible.
Good morning. Mike Bagley here on behalf of MARTA, along with my partner Vincent Ward and John Blackman. Wish all of you well. In a case of extreme candor, the Court of Appeals below commented on the potential result of their decision by calling it potentially absurd. And with that, we are in total agreement. They got that one right. We do disagree with the fact that the legislature is to blame for the absurdity, because we believe that the Court of Appeals made patent and clear errors in their interpretation of the statute. And I'll go into that in greater detail in a moment. This is a matter of great significance, even though the underlying case only involves about $560. It's a matter of great significance because if the Court of Appeals decision is allowed to stand, it will effectively open hundreds of thousands, perhaps millions, of workers' compensation claims over the past 24 years that prior to the decision of the Court of Appeals were thought to have been concluded by a reasonable application of the statute. And that is why we are greatly appreciative of the amicus briefs filed on behalf of many, many business and industry interests in the state of Georgia and commend it to you. At the heart of this matter is a request for a 15% enhancement of temporary total income benefits based upon a late payment of some benefits as required. The 15% is required by 349-221E. The claim started with an on-the-job injury in 1999. The claimant went in and out of work periodically over the next 2 years. He was paid temporary total disability benefits voluntarily, as is required by the Workers' Compensation Act. MARTA believed that they were paying him the appropriate amount of money and were paying him timely. He continued to work until 2002, continued to get these off and on until 2002, when he lost no more time as a result of the injury after 2002. There was no request for the enhanced benefit for late payment under 221 until 2010, almost 11 years after the original on-the-job injury and 8 years after the date of last payment of income benefits. And what was going on there was the claimant would be on work for a while, a week or two, off work for a week. He would be paid his benefits, but they would be late by a day or two. As it turns out, when the request was made, that became apparent. And MARTA admitted that. Well, you're right. 10 or 12 of these weekly benefits were late, but you're way past the statute of limitations in 104, and any claim for the $550 would be barred by the statute of limitations. Procedurally, all of the courts below the Court of Appeals agreed with MARTA. They all found that the enhancement of 221E was a request for increased benefits, and because of that, it was controlled by the two-year statute of limitations in 104B. All of those courts held that. The Court of Appeals disagreed, and they disagreed for two reasons. First, they said the change of condition statute of 104 doesn't apply because it only applies where there is a wage earning or physical condition issue. And second, the claimant's request was not for the modification of the prior application. And in doing so, they essentially overruled, without saying it, 23 years of case law surrounding this. And they also opened up, as I said, about 24 years of workers' compensation claims that were previously thought to have been concluded. The question which this court granted on cert was whether or not it was proper for the statute of limitations for the 221E penalties to be controlled by 349-82 or 349-104. And we submit to you that it's obvious and clear that 104B is applicable and controlling here. I'll give you a brief summary of our argument, then I'll go into specific details. In summary, the Court of Appeals decision violates multiple rules of statutory construction, three or four of them at least. 221E is clearly an increase in benefits, as held by every court that has addressed it, including the Court of Appeals on at least four occasions. And when you look at the statute, it's obvious that it's just an increase of benefits. A change in condition can be paid based upon three things, not two things, as the Court of Appeals held. Plain language of the statute says a change of condition can be based upon a change of wage earning, physical condition, or status. The Court of Appeals overlooked the third prong, status, and thereby found itself in, frankly, an absurd position. A status change here is requested from being what MARTA thought was someone who was fully and timely paid to the claimant contending his status was really untimely and underpaid. And under the law, the 15% enhancement would have been viewed as nothing more than income benefits. And under 349-104, any request for an increase, decrease, or ending of income benefits is a part of income benefits.
Yes, sir. I know you say that just read the statute, I think is what you're saying, it applies. But of your case law, what would you say would be your best authorities? in case law wise on this?
There are several of them on that point, Your Honor. Status change here is timely paid to unpaid. You know, the triggering event is this a request for increase of benefits? There are multiple cases, the Bailey case, which we cited in the brief, where the Court of Appeals itself said that the enhancement of 221E is part and parcel of compensation, close quote, that's their word. In the Handy case, they said, quote, compensation includes penalty. And in the Trent Blue versus Hurston case, it is included in not only as income, but they specifically said it was included for purposes of the statute of limitations under 104B, the very statute which is involved here. Trent Blue was the reverse of the actual situation we have here. In Trent Blue, the employer was arguing, well, you don't include penalties when you're calculating the benefits that were paid because these penalties really weren't due. And so the statute of limitations started running a lot earlier. The Court of Appeals in Trent Lute said, no, 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 you include the penalties that were paid, and they're a part of compensation, and the measure is from the date of the actual date of benefits paid, including the penalties, and that's where the two-year statute runs. So, Justice Hines, in response to you, probably Trent Lou is the best one. Now, the question was, yes, sir.
If the statute provides for automatic inclusion or that penalty of 15%, how is the claimant asking for an enhancement of benefits?
The statute provides for the payment of all income benefits automatically, but the statute leaves a debate over how much that is. It's a voluntary system. The employer calculates what they believe is owed based upon average weekly wage and the computations provided for under the Workers' Compensation Act. Just as the employer is required to make income benefits, if they're late, they're required to enhance it 15%.
And that's what made it by statute.
Yes, sir.
That's what made it penalty by statute.
Yes, sir. It's just as automatic as the requirement to pay the temporary total disability benefit itself.
So they're not asking for anything beyond what the statute's already imposed.
That's correct.
So they're not asking for enhanced benefits.
Well, yes, sir. If the dispute is whether it was timely or not, the employer operated as though it was timely because they thought it was timely and fully paid. Just as, for example, Your Honor, in the Cho decision that was handed down by the Court of Appeals just a month ago, there can be a debate over what the person's average weekly wage is. They're required to pay two-thirds of the average weekly wage up to a maximum. They're required to do that voluntarily within a certain amount of time. If that isn't done in a certain amount of time, that changes by 15%. It's all due automatic. There is no order. There is no legal activity that mandates it. It's all triggered by law from the get-go. And that is true. So the request for an increase, 104 uses that language. Any request for an increase, a decrease, or ending, it contemplates that fact. It contemplates the fact that the voluntary system can establish payments and be wrong. And they can be wrong because the calculations are wrong, or the wages that were paid were not really figured right, or something like that. Or they weren't paid timely. The statute anticipates that and says if there is a dispute to increase, decrease, or end, it has to be done within 2 years from the date that the actual payment of the last benefit was made. Obviously, the legislative intent is we need some finality. We can't let these things go on forever. And this isn't an onerous burden because it is a two-year statute which runs from the date of last benefits paid. In this case, it effectively would have been about 5 years after the original on-the-job injury. So any time during that point in time, the employee could have said, wait a minute, or frankly, the employer could have said, wait a minute, we didn't calculate those benefits right. We need to change these benefits. For whatever reason, we miscalculated them, they were late, so you're entitled to 15% more than the two-thirds you would normally get. For whatever reason, we need to increase, decrease, or end. We've got 2 years from the day of last payment. Now, the concept behind that, the policy behind that, is you don't want to delay this process of providing people with benefits by making the employer fear, well, if I start it now, I'm locked in. I can't ever change it. And it's on the other side, for the employee, you don't want them to say, well, if I accept it, I'm locked in. I can't ever change this. And I haven't had time to scrutinize it. I don't know if the numbers are right. So the statute has a concept built into it of kind. We can go ahead and do all of this voluntarily, and we can get the benefits rolling. And then at any time, for 2 years after the last time we pay it, somebody can come in and say, you know what? You were wrong. You miscalculated it. You miscalculated it because you had no wage wrong. You miscalculated it because you were late when you were paying it. And so the numbers are different. But the legislature only gave them 2 years, either side, 2 years from the last payment of benefits in which to do that. Now, of course, workers' compensation is totally different from the tort system. And I know Justice Benham is aware of this because he was a longtime practitioner in the field with my mentor, Charlie Drew. It doesn't start and end with the complaint and the judgment. And so we have two statutes of limitation. We have 82, 34982. The only thing you have to do with 34982 is file a form. You don't even have to request money. You don't have to request medical benefits. You don't have to request anything. Just file a form. That's all it requires. That's the front end statute. On the back end for income benefits is 104D. And that statute is the one that says, nothing's going on for 2 years after you last get income benefits. It's over. We've concluded the claim for income benefits at the end of 2 years. Now, let me talk about how 104 works. It's called the change of condition statute. It applies where three conditions are established by award or otherwise. And the statute's real clear on this. Wage earning capacity, physical condition, or status. Award or otherwise. Or otherwise has been interpreted by every one that's addressed it on appeal at the appellate level to be established when voluntary payment is made. It makes perfect sense. If an employer makes voluntary payment, they have decided that what the person's wage earning capacity is, whether they're disabled, their physical condition, and their status, whether they're entitled to get benefits under the law or not. In fact, the Court of Appeals themselves, in the Weir case, said direct payment to an employee, voluntarily by an employer, establishes their status, and that was over a decade ago. So a change of condition can occur for those three conditions: wage earning capacity, physical condition, or status. The Court of Appeals overtly and patently in the order missed the third prong. They said we can't address 221E under 104 because 221E enhancement doesn't involve a change in wage earning capacity or physical condition. There's a quote in the brief where they said that. You can see it in their order. Well, conspicuous by its absence is the third prong, status. The Court of Appeals just missed it. And if you look at Webster's dictionary, the word status has perfect meaning for the purpose here. Of the condition of a person in the eyes of the law. And the status was the third prong by the legislature to cover those things like we're here today on that don't involve physical condition or wage earning capacity. There are other examples in the Workers' Compensation Act. In 104A2 is a provision where total disability benefits automatically shift to partial disability benefits after a period of time, 52 consecutive weeks or 78 in the aggregate. Doesn't involve a change in physical condition or wage earning capacity. It just involves a change of status. Catastrophic designation. A person can be a quadriplegic. Their condition will not change. Their wage earning capacity will not change. But it has been held that if, in order for them to meet the requirements of a change of condition, that is a change of status that is subject to the statute of limitations under 104B. It's subject to the statute of limitations under 104B, even though it doesn't require a change of physical condition or a change of wage earning condition. That's the Williams versus ConAgra case that we cited in our brief. The change here, the status change here, was from timely and fully paid to untimely and underpaid. And the claimant was contending that he was entitled to a 15% enhancement of disability benefits as required by 221D. And if you read 221D, it's clear it's just an enhancement of benefits. The word penalty is not mentioned anywhere in the statute. You can call it a penalty if you want. It doesn't matter. But the statute makes clear that this is an increase of the income benefits that is due at the same time that the income benefits are due. It's just an enhancement of income benefits. Every court that's looked at this, the Court of Appeals, has looked at it 3 or 4 times. They have always held, as I told you just a time, they've always held that the penalties or enhancements of 221D are just income benefits, nothing more, nothing less. Therefore, 104B says that any party requesting an increase, a decrease, or ending of income benefits is bound by the statute of limitations in 104B, which is 2 years from the date of last payment. And that is what all the courts below the Court of Appeals held. That's what the Court of Appeals should have held. Unfortunately, they missed the status element. We believe that there's clear legislative intent here that insists upon finality, and there's only one way to impose finality, and that is to apply 104B to state situations where status has changed, as it has here. The 221 increases clearly income benefits. 104B imposes a 2-year statute of limitation where anyone requests an increase of income benefits, and we request that you reverse. I'd like to reserve my remaining 2 minutes for that. Thank you.
All right. Yes, sir.
Good morning. I'm Todd Major, representing Michael Reid in this case. It's a pleasure to be here. May it please the court, Justice Thompson, I think you went right to the heart of this case. Mr. Reed's contention is there is no enhancement involved in this case whatsoever. The money's owed by law. It's in the statute. It's in the statute. It's in 221E. It's automatic. The same case that opposing counsel cited to is a case that we rely upon, that being the Hardy's versus Bailey case, a case that says penalties are part and parcel of compensation, not separate and distinct benefits, makes it as clear as it can be that there's no enhanced benefit. It is not the condition itself.
Both of you understand kind of the case is the Hardy's versus Bailey case, but you look at it differently. Is that what you're arguing is your best authority also?
No, sir, that's not my best authority. I just thought to address what Justice Thompson had said, I just wanted to start with that. We are interpreting it differently, Justice, absolutely. My interpretation is, though, that in saying that it's part and parcel of compensation, there's nothing enhanced. It is the compensation in and of itself. So that's the distinction that we draw. There's never been a statute of limitations related to the pursuit of underpaid benefits in the Workers' Comp Act, nor should there be. Mr. Reed thinks that perhaps the best reason for that was actually expressed by this court in 1984 in the Bright versus Nemo case, where this court said in addressing the implications of Section 221E that we note, that being the court, Supreme Court, we note that almost every delay in payment by a solvent payor will be willful and intentional, with the consequences upon the payee being dependent upon the payee's financial circumstances. They know it's late. They know they missed the payment.
Well, is that clear from the record that both sides knew that the payments were late?
The record, Your Honor, stipulated that MARTA doesn't dispute that the payments are late. As for if they knew at the time they made it, they were late, I cannot address that. But all I can say to the court is that there's no dispute. And in fact, all the facts have been stipulated since day one in this case.
Everything necessary for the invocation of a penalty is stipulated in the record?
Yes, sir. Marty admits they have a penalty. They're just saying it's been so long they don't have to pay it anymore. The history of the statute, that being 34982, reflects that it applies here, not 34984, excuse me, 349104. As you look back at the history of the statute, and I went into a lot of that in my brief. I tried to give a historical analysis of what this system has been all about. Because there was a major change in the statute in 1978 when we went to the direct payment system. Before then, we had an agreement system where one of two ways is how injured workers got paid. Either the parties agreed and the State Board of Workers' Compensation approved that agreement, or if there was a dispute, the State Board of Workers' Compensation would hear the case, make an award. It was one of those two ways. That implies, obviously, a great deal of State Board of Workers' Compensation input with regard to the amount of money that was being paid. And significantly, the case law in those cases makes it clear that if employers and insurers ever wanted to cut off benefits for whatever reason, one of the requirements that was absolutely needed was a showing that all the statutory benefits had been paid before they would be entitled to cut off benefits.
Mr. Mayor, would you address the 1990 amendments to the statute to the workers' compensation? And how they apply in this case or don't apply?
We don't really see them as having that big an effect, Justice Hines. The 1990 amendment, there's been a lot of to-do. You heard about these, millions of cases, hundreds of thousands of cases. We find it hard to believe that many insurance companies and that many employers could be wrong. The fact is that in 1990, what was done was that the law was changed to make it to where if it used to be the law had been interpreted that if benefits were potentially due, that benefits that had never been paid before could be recovered. There's a line of cases. Holtz Bakery is a case, and it was, as people call it, being legislatively overruled. But what the law did in 1990 is it made the receipt of the benefits, the actual receipt of the benefits, the trigger in terms of the two-year statute, not the potentially due aspect. We don't really see that as being particularly relevant in this case. This is pure statutory construction. Is the money owed or isn't it? And we believe that the way that the law is now and the way the law has developed since 1978 makes it clear that the State Board has the power within itself, within its jurisdiction, to rule on these types of issues. Built into the workers' compensation system since 1978 have been two specific statutes. One in particular is 349221J. And it says that the board or any administrative law judge shall issue such orders as may be necessary to enforce the penalty provisions of this code section. The word penalty does appear in the statute. It's in 221J. Obviously, we're talking about 221E. That's the 15% penalty for the late payment. So that particular subsection, 221J, that gives the State Board and its judges power to issue any orders as may be necessary to enforce it, is right there in the same code section. And there's no statute of limitations limiting the board's power to do so. Secondly, OCGA 349-100. For the first time, the State Board of Workers' Compensation was given power on its own motion to look at issues having to do with whether or not employees had been fully and completely paid. 349-100 arose out of Code Annotated 114706, which followed 114705, which was the agreement system. 349100 is the enforcement mechanism in case people don't do the right thing when it comes to paying injured workers. And if you look at 349100, the board is given significant powers in terms of what they can do to enforce the provisions of the Workers' Compensation Act. The board can make or cause to be made any investigation it considers necessary. There's no statute of limitations on that. Once the case has been filed under 349-82, which is how 349-100 begins, that jurisdiction attaches, that power attaches. We don't believe that's a superfluous statute. We think it means something. Investigate must mean something. We believe in this case it clearly would apply to investigating whether or not an injured worker had received all the benefits to which he or she is entitled under the law. In addition, and as the court will see, there's going to be an amicus brief filed on behalf of Mr. Reid. it'll get into even more history about how this statute evolved, how this direct payment system evolved. And the court will be shown that the councils for state governments had prepared model acts in the early 1960s and the early 1970s that did a lot of what is in the Georgia statute, which gives the state board of workers' compensation the power to act on this issue, follows the recommendations that were made by the council for state governments. The 34-9-100 powers are also necessary because without them, injured workers and their entitlement to receive penalties would be treated differently in the event that the penalties were awarded in an award from state board of workers' compensation, or if they received the benefits as a result of a voluntary payment. The Ayers versus Brenner case, which has been cited to the court, indicates that the old law and the agreement system still applies. That is, if you have an award even after 1978, and that award says that employer insurers need to pay injured workers whatever amount of money it may be, that the injured worker can go to the superior court of the proper county and ask for enforcement of that. That is still good law. And in Ayers versus Rembert, a 20% penalty is provided for in 221 for non-compliance with awards was automatically issued. 34-9-100 gives the state board of workers' compensation to do a similar thing. That is, in situations where under the voluntary payment system of the direct payment system, if the injured worker is not paid appropriately, the state board has the inherent power under 34-9-100, as long as a case has been filed properly under 34-9-82, to do the same thing, to issue an award for penalties and have those penalties paid to the injured worker, as is and has always been the intention of the direct payment system. As I started off with, Mr. Reid indicates or believes that the unpaid penalties are not additional compensation. Not only the Hardy's versus Bailey case, but the Hamby case as well is a case that we rely upon, because it says that the penalties in 221E are not a separate amount required of the employer. Unpaid penalties, as correctly found by the Court of Appeals, are part of the initial claim. The initial claim of the injured worker, not as a result of any type of a change in condition. The discussion of additional compensation in the cases cited by MARTA, they all deal with situations where injured workers are basically seeking a recommencement of income benefits after benefits had been terminated, after they had been back to work, and then after they had suffered a worsening of their physical condition or earning capacity. There's the Slattery Associates versus Huffstetler case. There's the Clark versus Sampson Manufacturing case. There's the ITT Thompson Industries versus Wheeler case. All of them stand for that proposition. We do not have that here. Mr. Reid is not trying to have new benefits recommenced because of a change in his economic condition or a change in his physical condition. He's just trying to get the money that's been owed to him since day one. That's not a change in status. His status has never changed.
It wasn't owed until the payments became late.
Excuse me, Your Honor?
It wasn't owed until the payments became late. There was something different that happened in the interim. It wasn't since day one. It was
day since one, the day.
Since they became late.
Yes, sir. Since they were untimely paid, they've been due.
Right.
Every employer insurer knows if they don't make the payment as required under the direct payment system in 221, every employer insurer knows that they not only owe what that weekly benefit is supposed to be, but as part and parcel of that weekly benefit, they're supposed to add 15%. So since that very day, since that first payment was made, it's been the wrong amount of money. And it's been owed that whole entire time.
Does the statute ever run on these late payments?
No, sir. Not as far as I can see. I do not see the statute running on the late payments in particular. No, sir. Nor should they. This is a direct payment system that the employer insurers are given great responsibility and great power. And most of the injured workers in this state are unrepresented. And as part of that responsibility, they're supposed to pay the right amount of money. And if they do not pay the proper amount of money, they can be ordered by the State Board of Workers' Compensation, as long as it's a pending claim. And that's a point, too, that I want to make sure the board is aware of. We're just talking about pending open claims. We're not talking about going back and open and unsettled cases or resolved cases. We're talking about cases that are still open and pending.
Well, I said earlier, though, that the case would remain open as long as it's anything getting paid.
Excuse me, Your Honor.
I think you argued earlier, though, that the case would remain open as long as there was anything still here.
The entitlement of the employee to the penalties remains open as long as the case is open, or he is entitled to those benefits as long as the case is open. That's the point I was trying to make.
But as long as he was entitled to those benefits, the case would stay open.
Well, Your Honor,
As long as the case remains open and is not settled, then he's entitled to those penalties.
But as long as money's open, it remains open.
Yes, sir. That's correct. Because it's not a changing condition. There's been no change in status. The status is the same and has been the same since the case began. There have been a couple of cases that the Court of Appeals looked at where there was an attempt to use, instead of looking at earning capacity, instead of looking at physical condition, they looked just at it. Was there a change in status? It's the City of Atlanta versus Webb, or Webb versus City of Atlanta, and the Spada versus Union County case. Both of those cases found it very important that if there's been no change in the status of the injured worker since the inception of the claim, there can be no change in condition. And in the Webb versus City of Atlanta case, what they were dealing with was an injured worker who was not only getting benefits for his income benefits because of his injury, he was also getting disability payments on top of that. And he was getting that throughout. Court of Appeals says that's not a change in status. That's what it was since the case began. In the Spiva case, the issue was whether or not the injured worker had told the entire truth when his benefits had commenced. And the Court of Appeals again said that's not a change in status. Since the inception of the claim, nothing has changed. And that's what we're arguing here. Since
I don't understand how you make that argument. There is a status that exists when the claim is finalized and they start making payments. Then when they have a late payment, that's something new that creates an additional amount of money that's due. That's not something that existed from day one. That's something that exists sometime after day one. How do you say that always was there?
Because what we're saying, Justice, is that that money was always owed.
It was the additional payment for being late was always owed from day one.
Yes, sir. From the day it was paid late, it was always owed.
Okay, but the late payments were triggered the additional amount of money. You have an additional amount of money, you have an amount of money that's owed.
Yes.
Then there's a late payment. Then that late payment triggers an additional amount of payment.
No, I'm not making myself clear. Marta's position is that their erroneous payment of money established a status. Their admitted failure to follow the law established a status. And that Mr. Reid, as the injured worker, has 2 years from their admittedly erroneous payment to file for what they consider to be a changing condition, or else it's just too late.
I'm trying to understand your statement that the additional payment for filing late is not anything new.
The point I'm trying to make, apparently not doing such a good job, is that the amount of money, that penalty money, is due at the same time as, but in addition to, that's owed at the exact same time the late payment is made. If more than 7 days goes by, they haven't made a payment. The employer insurer owes not only the income benefit itself, but the 15% penalty at the same time. They didn't pay it. That doesn't change. Their failure to abide by the statute doesn't change his status. His status is an underpaid injured worker. Changing condition cases also, in looking at the other cases, indicate that we're still dealing with economic changes in condition and earnings capacity cases. The Maloney case that was decided by this court still carries forth that particular point of law. That when you're talking about changing condition cases, you're not talking about late payment penalties. You're talking about whether or not injured workers are entitled to the recommencement of income benefits as a result of the worsening of their physical condition or worsening of their earnings capacity. There are no implied statutes of limitations. A review of the statutes involved in this case shows that there is nothing here to indicate that any type of statute of limitation would apply to an underpayment. What MARTA is asking for you to imply that there is a statute of limitations here, and not only you just imply it, but imply it based upon their admitted error. We don't believe that there is a hole in the statute whatsoever. We don't believe that it's absurd that employer and insurers be held to paying for everything that they're obligated to pay under the law. We believe that the decision of the Court of Appeals was correct, and we ask that you affirm. Thank you.
Ms. Baker, any rebuttal?
Yes, sir. I'd like to follow up on something mentioned by Justice Hines and alluded to by Justice Milton and you, Justice Thompson. The idea that there is no statute of limitations for 221A income benefits due but unpaid, which is the argument we've heard. And Justice Hines asked about the 1990 amendments, and that is at the heart of it. This is like Grandpa Day, because in pre-1990, the statute read that the two-year limitation period ran from the last payment of income benefits due. In the Holtz-Baker case and Wet Walls, the Court of Appeals said, well, that means if there's anything that possibly was due but unpaid, the statute never started to run. That's the exact argument we're hearing today. The problem is, in 1990, the legislature completely changed that. They deleted income benefits due, and they said the statute runs from the last date of income benefits actually paid. It doesn't matter whether they're underpaid, overpaid. Trent Lude stands for that. Even if they're overpaid, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's just the day that you last paid income benefits. The cardinal rule of statutory interpretation is legislative intent. It is absolutely clear that in 1990, the legislature wanted to put finality on this. And to measure the two-year statute of limitations where income benefits have been paid, as they were here, and an increase in income benefits is requested, as it is here, is limited to 2 years. That's the only way to have finality. That's the only way to give every portion of the statute meaning. And that requires a reversal of the Court of Appeals. Thank you very much.
Well, thank both sides. It's been very helpful. Appreciate the audience. Thank you all this day.
S13G1793, the State versus Ernest Walker Sr., Daniel Bidler for appellant, Angela Coggins for appellant.